Hi, welcome to another video. This is Mr. Chow from EnglishTuition.org. Now, as promised, I'll be making a video on what had happened for the past year. So this will be kind of a reflective video for the year 2019, just to see what we have done, you know, how we could have done things better, hoping to find some ways to improve on the teaching. And hopefully you can find some tips that will be useful to your child. Overall, the progress of the students has been smooth sailing. Everybody had been able to pass, right? It's a matter of whether they have achieved their personal goals or not, and they have no issues moving up to the next level. There were a couple of minor surprises, which I mentioned, okay, especially for the PSI students. I already mentioned that in another video, so I won't be repeating that here. The first thing that I would want to pick up, okay, from the year 2019, now, I've been teaching for about 5 years now. Next year will be my 6th year. And I've noticed and observed that some of the students have resorted to cherry-picking when they were asked to do their work. In other words, they are in the habit of just choosing to do the things that they like. Things that they don't like, they just don't do. I do not know whether you observe similar type of behavior in your child. I think we can see this type of behavior manifesting in many different forms, because some kids may just choose to eat certain foods, right? If they don't like vegetables, then I'm not going to touch. I don't care what you say. I don't care what are the benefits. I am just not going to touch the vegetables, right? Some kids don't like to exercise. So no matter what you say, no matter what the benefits are, it's very difficult to convince them, you know, to at least take up some form of exercise. So as a result, they don't exercise, and then they are drawn to maybe sugary stuff, and I'm just going to eat more of that sugary stuff, and no matter what anybody says, I'm not going to do my exercise. So the result is that they grow fat, they have low energy, and this affects their performance in their studies as well. So this cherry picking thing, I think, has got a lot to do with parenting as well as the teaching methods. When I was still starting teaching, at first I was giving my students a lot more slack. Okay, I was a lot more lenient, and you know, usually I consult them, okay, as to what they would like to do more, you know, and I try to convince them that if these are the weak areas that you need to work on, then you have to work on these areas in order to improve. So I spend a lot of my time, a lot of effort trying to convince them, right, and influence them. But I find that for some students, they are just too stubborn, and the time lost having to try to convince these students to, you know, agree to practice on the exercises, we are not going to get back. All right. So going forward, I don't think I want to spend a lot more time, okay, doing the convincing. Okay. I tell myself that, you know, for the interest of the students, I have to be strict, right? In order for you to improve, now since that you have come here for lessons, then you know, you have to be cooperative and start to practice the lessons. You have to work on the areas that needs the improvement. Alright, no more cherry picking and say that, you know, I don't like writing. Don't, you can ask me to do anything, but just don't write. And these words I quote from one of my ex-students, right? And eventually she did not do well because she couldn't write at all. So that's like throwing away 1/3 of the marks for the subject, and very difficult to get her to improve, right? Because didn't want to practice at all, right? Didn't want to write, didn't want to read, all right? So that is one thing to take note of, cherry picking. I think from the parents' perspective, right, I do feel that, you know, parents need to be more mindful of such behavior as well, because a lot of parents tend to go like, "Aiya, never mind lah, I know he's still young lah, just let him do whatever he wants," okay? The thing is, when the challenges come, the problems come, you know, it's very difficult to change that habit, right? Because the kid is just so used to, you know, getting what he wants. Whatever he doesn't want, doesn't like, he just doesn't do it, right? He doesn't want to do homework, he just doesn't do it. Very stubborn, very willful, all right? So I think a lot of students, they are not old and wise enough to make decisions that are in their own best interest. So sometimes the adults do have to step in and make those decisions on their behalf. So maybe here's one tip, right? One trick that I usually like to use. Okay, usually I just tell them, no, you now at this age, at this time, you do have to listen to what the teachers and the parents say, right? There will come a point in time when you're old enough and mature enough, you want to do what you want, you're old enough to bear the consequences, right? On your own, right? Then, of course, the freedom eventually will be yours to make those decisions. But right now, right, at this age, you have to listen to the adults, all right? The next point that I would like to bring up is complacency. Now, again, I think this is nothing new because a lot of students, okay, I realize that when they start to feel confident that they can score for a certain subject, they have a tendency to let their guard down to the point that they surprise themselves when they see their grades drop. So this is particularly obvious when, you know, we know that a student is very good in a certain subject, but because they think that they are so good, they let their guard down, their efforts start to slacken, alright, and the homework is not so consistent, and they put in less effort in that subject, and they try to maybe focus on other subjects. And when that happens, usually when the grade comes back, they're in for a big unpleasant surprise, right? This has happened to a few of my students, and 2019, one particular case stood out, because this student has got pretty good foundation. Okay, he's got actually scored 69.9%, right, in his SEC 2 for the overall year for the subject. So 69.9 is almost an A2, which is a distinction. Okay, he tried to fought for that 0.1%, but it's just printed that the teachers or the school refused to give it to him. So he got a B3, right? So the skills are obviously there. But by the time he got to SEC 3 mid-year exam, he actually failed the English exam. Okay, he got a D7. And when I looked at the paper, okay, it was horrendous, right? And we never expected that. We expected the student to be responsible for their own performance and to have that maturity, right, to hold themselves accountable. But apparently, this student needs more reminders and more supervision. Then we ask ourselves, so what happened? How can, you know, a B3 grade suddenly drop to D7, right? Obviously, the language skills are still there, but they can become rusty if you don't use them. So he went into a little bit of a panic mode, and by the end of the year, he was able to pull his grades up to get a C5 grade, which is a confident pass, but it was nothing to brag about, right? It wasn't a good, it wasn't a pleasant experience to have, okay? Because, he kind of panicked, right? As you know, in secondary schools, if you fail your English, you either can't promote, okay, or you get relegated to the lower stream, right? From express to NA, normal academic, or from NA to NT, normal technical, right? So whatever you do, don't fail English, especially in secondary schools, okay? So for me, I just need to constantly remind myself to remind the students to always be vigilant, even if you're getting very good grades, okay? The next challenge, okay, celebrate, you know, your success, right? But the next challenge is coming, all right? So focus on the next challenge and don't become complacent. The next point I want to bring up, this is nothing new as well, is consistency, right? So from what I observe from my students, the students who are able to do well, that students who I don't have to worry about, okay, they are always consistent with their work. Every week they come, the homework is done, is finished. I really don't have to worry about them. I don't have to remind them, hey, you know, it's time to do your homework. I don't have to give out warnings, right? It's time to, you know, do your homework, or I have to get your parents involved, all the kind of nonsense, right? And when the effort is consistent, then they have a much higher chance of getting the results that they're after, and that's exactly what happened. So when the effort is not consistent, like I mentioned, right, some students start to slack in their homework, they don't complete the worksheets when I give them out during the lessons, and some of them even try to skip lessons over, you know, frivolous reasons, right? They just, you know, have a bit of runny nose and I don't feel like going for lesson, then they don't go for lessons. The good students will, apart from completing their weekly homework, also complete their worksheets, and if they can't come for lessons for whatever reason, alright, they will usually contact me automatically and ask for a makeup lesson, so they don't miss the weekly lesson. So bear in mind that I only see the students once a week. So if they don't come for lessons, then that is no 2 weeks I don't see them, right? So there's nobody to remind them, okay, to get them to refocus on the subject. And pretty soon, if they miss enough lessons, they will go off track. The fourth point that I want to mention that is preventing students from achieving their results is that for some strange reason, right, some students stray from the teaching. Okay, I think happens, now that I reflect upon it, it happens more than we notice, right? It happens more than we realize, okay? Because some students, when they go for lessons and there's an adult sitting there supervising them, doing their work, they do the work, they pay attention so as, you know, they don't get the scolding, right? But after they leave the lessons, right, they're like, ooh, free, I'm king of the mountain, all right? So I'm the monkey king, right? I can be, you know, go back to my monkey ways, right? And then they forget about the teaching, right? So it doesn't matter whether it's the teaching from me or from the school teachers, right? They just, well, when they were when they are alone doing their own exam papers or test papers, they just revert back to their old style, old way of doing things because nobody is looking, right? And they think that, you know, oh, I can get away with it. They don't have the foresight, right, to know that, you know, if they come back with bad results, suddenly they are going to get something, right, from the teachers and maybe from the parents as well, okay? But they do not yet have that foresight. So they just, you know, just do their normal way, you know, they're careless, they forget about the teaching, they forget about the question answering techniques. You know, despite the teachers remind us to, hey, you must always do this, remember to do this, remember to do this, okay? But they forget. Now, if they stray from the teaching, then the result that comes back will usually be, you know, worse than expected, right? Because I can give the mock assessment to the students. And from the mock assessment, I can see whether the child knows the techniques or not. But during the exams, I'm not there, right, to supervise the child. Okay, they have to depend on themselves to do the paper properly. Okay, if they're careless, they don't read the text properly, they don't consider their answers carefully, right, then they're prone to careless mistakes. And this is something that prevents a lot of them from achieving the results that they're after. All right, and it's something that, you know, can be prevented, right? Just they just have to keep their guard up and remind themselves, right, okay, what was the teaching, right? Usually during practice, how were they doing it? They just have to use what they have been doing during the practice, okay, in the actual exam itself, and then they will be able to get the good results that they're after. And then before I bring the video to a close, there's one more point that I would like to mention, okay, which this kind of a new point because I've never mentioned them in the videos before. That's about mental agility and the overall maturity development of the student. Now, if I teach knowledge and things like vocabulary, okay, and grammar, I can only bring the student standard up to a certain extent, all right? But as the language, as the subject progresses, okay, when we go to Sec 2, Sec 3, Sec 4, and eventually JC, general paper, okay, a lot of times the language paper starts to discuss about various topics, and we expect some level of maturity from the students. So what I've noticed is that the students who are able to get an A, okay, when they move on to upper secondary, okay, they are able to give a mature response, a mature and intelligent and considered response, all right, and then they can come up with good conclusions. So these type of responses put them in a very positive light, so they can score well for oral, for example, right, and they can score very well for essays, and even if the comprehension passages are a little bit complex, they are able to understand the issues that are being discussed in the comprehension text. Now, conversely, some of the students, they know a lot of words, they have been building up their vocabulary bank, but the maturity has not developed over time, and by the time they reach upper sec, they are still very childish and they are not taking the subject very seriously. And sometimes when I ask some of the students, when was the last time you had a serious conversation about something, they are unable to answer me, because most of the time, I don't know what they're talking about with their friends or at home, right? Maybe they're talking about video games, talking about kid stuff, and you want to talk to them about serious stuff, oh, that's a boring stuff. Well, let's not talk about that, okay? But talking about and discussing about serious issues are the conditions necessary to develop the maturity of the student. maybe I see this more in boys rather than girls, because girls maybe tend to mature faster. I don't really know. Okay, but if girls also, you know, don't like to talk about serious matters, don't like to consider serious issues, and you know, just want to kid around and, you know, and just speak about the things that they like to talk about, okay, then I suspect they are going to have an issue with the subject once they get to higher level English. So I think the questions we need to ask ourselves, or ask the students, we need to ask themselves, right, is that has their maturity developed over time? Okay, so this is something that I think adults need to be wary about and check on them every now and then. Okay, have they been, you know, reading the news, keeping up with current affairs, you know, like really take an active interest in issues that are beyond themselves, right? Issues that are taking place in the community itself, right? If they have, then they should be able to give you some form of intelligent response. And then, are the students able to adapt when the questions change, right? Some students that I teach, if I teach them something, right, they have good memory and they're able to retain that knowledge. So I teach them how to tackle certain questions, they're able to do it. But then when the questions change, they don't know what to do anymore, right? So this type of mental agility is more challenging to teach, right? And students need to practice. You know, I try this exercise A, try exercise B, this also can, that also can. And they have this adaptability, they are able to, you know, deal with a wider range of questions. Then they have a higher chance of scoring, you know, consistently well for the subjects, right? So if they're not taught something, does that mean that they can't come up with the answers on their own? I don't think that's a good thing. So they do have to try to develop the thinking skills, right, to try to figure things out on their own, even if they are not taught. Alright, this video is getting a bit long. I have completed all the points that I want to mention in this reflective video. Just very quickly, take a couple of minutes to just go through the PSI results summary, okay, for the students that I had. Right, first year I'm into teaching, okay, I was still teaching at MOE, so not really taking on students actively. Okay, and then year two of teaching is when I started full time giving private tuition. And then I had two students taking PSI English. Both of them did not score A's, both of them scored B. One is the students, you know, she just wasn't that good. Her overall aggregate is only 200 and she scored a B. The other one was also, you know, the English is the weakest subject. So I always get students like this. And I didn't even get one full year with him. So by PSI time, he wasn't able to get A. By year 3, okay, year 3, I had two students taking PSLE, okay, and this is my best year so far because both students are very good students. They are able to, they were strong in English in the first place, right? So all they needed were maybe some guidance, okay, and both of them scored A's for PSLE English, and that's the first year I had two students scored A, okay, for English. Year 4 only had one student taking PSLE English. Okay, and that student got A, so I actually, he has a chance of getting B. So it was fortunate that he was able to get an A. It's good for him, right? And then year 5, okay, which is this year, I had 4 students taking PSLE English, only one got A. And the other 3 who got B is only one, I expected him to get A, but he did not. Great. The other 2, one did not join long enough, he was here only for about slightly less than half a year, and the other boy was very weak at English. So a lot of these students who are weak at English in the first place, the goal is to always get to try to at least get them to a strong B. All right, so some of these students are even worrying about, you know, failing their exams, okay, and to get them to a strong B is not an easy thing to do. So nothing wrong with getting a B, right? So if you can get from, you know, a weak score to a strong B, that's a major achievement, okay? So, but to sum up all the results, I have like consecutively, you know, having students getting A starting from year 3, year 4, year 5, so 3 years in a row. And for next year, 2020, I'm not sure, right? Whether the students get A or not depends on the crop of students that I have for next year. And then I do believe in 1 or 2 weeks time, I will be publishing the schedule, okay, for the students on my website. So please remember to visit the website if you are interested in signing up for the lessons. And that's all I have in this video. Okay, don't want to take up too much of your time. If you're still watching this, thank you very much. Okay, for watching. Hopefully you've learned something useful. Okay, I'll talk to you soon in another video. Okay, bye-bye.